I'm Dr. Neil Park, Director of Clinical Affairs at Glidewell Laboratories, and we're here in San Diego at the annual meeting of the Academy of Osseointegration. Our guest today is Dr. Stephen Chu. Dr. Chu is a prosthodontist in Manhattan, and he's a leader in the field of aesthetic dentistry, a very popular speaker internationally, and he's done a lot of great writing and research, particularly in the field of soft tissue aesthetics around dental implants. Welcome, Dr. Chu.
Thank you, Neil. Appreciate it.
Absolutely, absolutely. So could we maybe start by just telling us a little bit about yourself, your background, where you grew up, and how you got involved in the field of dentistry?
Yeah, I grew up on Long Island. I'm from New York, and had went to different schools up in Rhode Island and UPenn. So undergraduate, I went to Brown University, and then I went to UPenn for dental school, and then I went out to the West Coast to Seattle for prosthetics. And the reason why I got involved in dentistry is that when I was going to Brown, I had spoken to my mother, and we had conversations in reference to what I should do. You know, obviously Asian parents are very focused that in high school you know exactly what you're going to do in the rest of your life. And so I was always interested in carpentry and woodwork. In fact, in high school I did a lot of woodwork with, you know, wood shop right. at the time. And I found that really interesting. Brown University had a relationship with RISD, Rhode Island School of Design, which is a very famous school. So I had taken some art classes there. The only problem is that when I told my mother I wanted to be like a carpenter, she said, the only problem with that is that carpenters don't have a prefix in front of their name, a DR in front of their name. So my mother was like, you're not doing that. But the whole point was that I really enjoyed working with my hands, and I find that what we do in prosthetics and prosthodontics is not that dissimilar from the artistic side of creating something for patients. So that was sort of the history behind it. And my dad is a civil engineer. So the combination of the two, I thought that was good. So I decided that dentistry was probably a better fit because there was so much involved with working with your hands.
And when you were going through dental school, had you already decided that you were going to go into prosthodontics?
Not necessarily. What I realized is that obviously, there's certain subject matters that you sort of gravitate to. And I found that I wasn't very good at doing endodontics, and I really didn't like surgery very much. So I found that prosthetics was something that I really enjoyed very much. I really liked the lab part, which is one of the areas that I've, you know, delved in further into besides prosthetics, is doing more lab training, is because I really liked the technical aspect. So I felt that prosthodontics was perfect for me.
You know, Stephen, there's so many great prosthodontic programs around the country, and each seems to be known for different things. How did you select the University of Washington for your PROS program?
That's a great question, Neil, because when I went to Penn, a lot of the philosophy of perio-PROS was very prevalent during the 70s when Arnie Weisgold was running the perio-PROS program, but Morty Amsterdam, obviously, the philosophy that sort of bled down through that. And when I wanted to go into prosthetics, I had asked Arnie Weisgold, in fact, I had applied to the Penn program, but I asked many professors that I admired, like Ed Rosenberg, Richard Tobey, who was my professor, Arnie Weisgold. And what continually came up in the response as far as a really good prosthetic program was the University of Washington in Seattle that the late Ralph Yudelis ran. And it had a lot of similar philosophy in perio-PROS, but more focused in prosthetics. For instance, if you go to Penn's program, you become certified and you receive a certificate in periodontics, but not prosthodontics, right. Even though I know Ernesto Lee is trying to change that now, which I think is great. But when you go to the University of Washington, it's a perio-PROS program, but you're certified in prosthodontics, not periodontics.
Interesting.
And I found that that was very appealing to me. And when I went there, I realized that I was in the right place because, you know, people like Frank Spear, John Coyce, Bob Fauché, all these other people who were, you know, top students. But when I went there, I realized I was in the right place because I saw things and wax-ups that you only dream about seeing.
Right.
And I realized that Ralph Yudelis had really made a program that had a very high standard, and his legacy was keeping to that standard. And I just, that was the program for me. And I think the heritage of those individuals have carried on the lineage and legacy of what Ralph Yudelis was trying to create. So I feel that I was that I was accepted. I was very thankful. In fact, I remember being in the clinic, you know, as a fourth-year student, and Ralph Udelis had called me.
Right.
And most people were doing a GPRs ahead of time, and he accepted me to go right into the program. And so when I asked people, they said, go right away. Don't squander that opportunity.
And, you know, you've mentioned that there's a nice bond between residents who came out of that program. Mm-hmm. Is that a continuing basis?
Yeah, I would think so. I think that, you know, things have obviously changed very much, but I think the lineage of being proud of being part of a program, and you see it in many programs, that the lineage is that people gravitate because they share the same experience.
Right.
And I think sometimes sharing the same experience is whether there's some challenges associated with that is almost a rite of passage. So I think that it's important that that lineage is carried through, and that's why the camaraderie among all UW graduates is so strong over the years. And it's also about respect. You know, they only took two students in per year, so it's a very small class. So it's almost like a little fraternity that we try maintain over the years uphold. In fact, at Chicago, they always get together, all the people.
Oh, that's nice.
That's sort of like a reunion that we try to get together.
You know, I've noticed that in addition to your dental degree and your specialty, you also have a CDT.
Mm-hmm.
And I was curious as to why you felt it was important to align yourself with our colleagues in dental technology.
Yeah, I think that's a very important one because if the analogy now is that for implant therapy and prosthetics, you know, surgeons are trying to learn more about prosthetics now and prosthodontists are trying to learn a little bit more about surgery. But the segue into prosthodontics without a lab background, I think personally is only going halfway. Because when we were in graduate school, one of the rite of passages was that Ralph Udelis would make you do lab work. And whether or not you set up the case properly or not, sometimes you didn't. But the learning process or the challenge was making the restorations. You could do a full arch and realizing that you had set up the case wrong and you'd have to redo all the lab work. And that was part of the learning process. He let people fail to understand that if you don't set up the case well, meaning occlusion, aesthetics, you don't prepare the teeth properly, you won't have enough room to create a nice restoration because we need room in the proper place. And he would let you purposely fail to experience what that felt like.
So a mistake you hopefully only make once, right?
Exactly, but trust me, you learn from that mistake. And the relationship of understanding, to be very honest, I know Gly was a lab, but the lab technicians sometimes know more than the dentist, and they can help the dentist become better dentists. Because if the final endpoint is reconstruction, and you don't know how to plan that, I mean, you're really in trouble. So the beauty behind the program in Seattle was to make you competent on that side, which is really the end delivery, and understand its value. When I graduated, I realized I had so much experience. Why couldn't I get a CDT? Because one of the challenges I had going back to the East Coast from the West Coast was not being able to get what I felt was needed for my practice. And then I had my own laboratory. I had friends then be able to, you know, send me lab work. And really from a standpoint of having certification, not only myself, but the lab technicians, I think was very important to have distinction that we're just not, you know, a mom and pop lab that we set up, but all the technicians were certified. And in fact, that was probably the toughest exam I've ever had to take. To take the CDT exam, they give you a half a day to bake a three and a bridge, wax a coping for, back then it was a butt margin crown, bake a butt margin crown in about 4 hours. And that's a lot of work. So there's a written and practical component. And I remembered Adam, our technician, telling me, he took the CDT practical part before me. And he told me, he says, when you take that, he says, I had about 10 minutes left to spare to finish the exam. He says, you have no time to waste time. So when I took the exam, I was very focused on that great tip. And I think a lot of people who fail the exam just don't even complete the requirements in such a short period of time. They fail because they can't even do all those procedures in the time. And I barely had enough time to finish. So that is something that I'm extremely proud of because that was sort of a hurdle, and also understanding and appreciating the importance of the laboratory. It is so important. Well, that's why I'm here now, yeah. because that message is a very important message.
Yeah, and I'm sure your comments are very much appreciated by the many CDTs we have at Gladwell.
It's funny because, you know, we always think of, or it's a mistake to think that technicians are second-class citizens in the whole arena. And I have the same admiration and respect for the technician as I do for the referring surgeon. They're the same. Yeah. They're on the equal basis because you can learn so much from them. And especially with CAD-CAM now, I think the technique or the procedures to have a consistent protocol to help streamline. Mm-hmm. You know, why is digital so popular now? It's really about streamlining and being efficient and getting more consistent outcomes. But to understand the protocol of how you need to do clinical procedures to make the end game, you know, consistent, you know, that's a learning curve. And sure. and I worked with Michael Bergler. I do work with Michael Bergler at UPenn because of their CAD-CAM unit there.
Right.
And he first prefaced and told me, he goes, look, you may not like to hear what I have to say as far as what I need from you, and I have a certain way of doing things, but you will then appreciate in the end result, we'll get very consistent outcomes. And it was painful. It was a painful learning curve initially, but I'll tell you, we have it down pat now, and we get very consistent outcomes on the full arch restorations. And he's taught me that without Michael and putting my ego aside to say, I can learn. Once you have an ego there, it blocks your learning. So I said, put it in the garbage can and learn from. And I think the CDT gives me that respect for the technicians.
To follow up on your comments about digital dentistry, as we know, digital dentistry has experienced a tremendous amount of growth. But one thing we've noticed at the laboratory is that still there's a very small percentage of cases that come in from digital impressions. Where are we in this technology? Is the technology ready for prime time? Are we at that magical tipping point, or do we still have a ways to go?
If I break it up into two parts on the lab side and digital dentistry, it is definitely about efficiency and really, you know, coming up with more consistent outcomes and how to streamline that. The whole concept of digital workflow, I think, is very important. And people who don't believe they're part of the digital revolution on any side is mistaken, because it's well adopted in the dental laboratory business. And what originally was all these players, I think, have been somewhat distilled to some major companies. So there's some consistency in knowing that the lab is partnering with a company that will be there long term instead mm-hmm. of just not being there in a couple of years. So that concept on the clinical side is also somewhat true, or something that we've thought about. And we want to know who are going to be the major players on the clinical side. So that may take a little bit more time for it to sort of, you know, figure out who are Check the major out, clinical yeah. players. And one of the other issues is also, you know, not just a company being there for you long term, but also the technology is very expensive right now. And it may not change that much long term, but one of the issues why we in our practice have not adopted the clinical side of digital dentistry is mostly because of cost. We have a 14-chair practice. We have 8 doctors. We would probably have to equip 5 mobile carts with the ability to have scanners, mm-hmm. of each one being about $50,000. So, you know, obviously it becomes, you know, fairly high. The question then becomes efficiency and time, and I know that that's been improving tremendously in regards to the time it takes to make impressions. But the bottom line is that if the technology or the hardware changes in 2 years or 3 years,
right.
I don't know if we're in the position, even with the big practice, that we could afford spending $250,000 on redoing the hardware every 2 or 3 years. And I think that's some of the challenges. If companies would then have the ability to take back old hardware and get some type of credit or reimbursement for it, I think that would help the adoption.
What about the issue of open systems versus closed systems? When this technology first came out, most of the systems were closed, and I believe I see a trend toward more open systems.
Yeah, the open systems just allows you, you know, not obviously to have the priority, and if the end game is to be able to provide a service to our patients, the closed systems obviously is about getting market share and being able to protect what you're doing. But open systems obviously would just benefit the profession, because It's just about providing a service to your patients.
Exactly. The dentist has more options in getting a restoration made if he's
right. And I understand the play that companies want. They want to protect, especially if they've invested in intellectual properties. But at some point in time, to service the industry, I mean, you have to go to an open system. Why not? Because then it's about your product. If you can differentiate your product is better, then even if it's open, that anybody could, you know, do it, but still the best company will come to the forefront because they have the best system or the best technology that can work with any
And that's certainly how we see it. We want to compete with the best product, not because you're locked into us.
Right, exactly. And I think that mindset of being locked in is a little bit of protectionism, which is understandable, but I'm not so sure long-term that that's going to happen. So, but I agree with you on that.
At Glidewell, we've seen a tremendous shift toward monolithic CAD/CAM restorations. You know, particularly in the implant field, we have the single screw-retained crown, monolithic crown, and we've got the full-arch monolithic Bruxer bridges. What's your opinion of this material and this method of construction?
As we were talking before, Neil, that, you know, I was doing a point-counterpoint at AO with Jörg Strube, and the question was, should we use, zirconium materials at that time? And what was amazing is that there was so much research talking about that if it goes through the phase change, that it'll start to degrade. But we don't see that happening. As you had mentioned, that Glidewell does so many of these restorations that clinically
over,
it's performing.
Over 10 million Bruxer.
Yeah, that's 10 million is a lot. And the key then becomes, we understand from Van Thompson's work that they were saying, well, if you have a monolithic, say, lithium disilicate, that can outperform a zirconia restoration. But the zirconia restorations were layered. So that's not comparing apples to apples. In fact, when I spoke to Daniel Edehoff from Munich, you know, he says you have to compare apples to apples. So compare a monolithic zirconia to a monolithic lithium disilicate. And I'll say, not to say that lithium disilicate monolithic is not a good material. It's an excellent material. But then compare it to a monolithic zirconia material. And they do equally as well.
Right.
So, you know, we have to compare apples to apples. And I think that monolithic zirconia is an outstanding material. We just have to understand that if you are using it for a single unit or a multiple unit restoration, that inserting a metal insert through, say, gluing or using some of the materials like Ivoclar makes a cement, for implant cement for that, that it's very important that you have a metal-to-metal interface. Actually, Tom Taylor at the University of Connecticut showed on some studies that if you use a monolithic zirconia insert into a metal implant, that if it becomes loose, that you could theoretically have wear of that metal interface because the zirconia is much harder than the titanium. Yeah. So they caution those issues, or at least they brought some awareness to that. And I think even from a standpoint of long-term longevity and not having breakage, I've had some breakage of single units, especially in smaller diameter abutments. So I think the metal interface is very important. But one of the caveats associated with the monolithic, say, single unit restoration on the molar is that not all manufacturers that make the metal inserts to be glued into the zirconia have a chimney that's tall enough. In fact, one of my friends, classmates from the West Coast referred a patient because the actual zirconia crown had de-cemented from the metal insert. And when I looked at the metal insert, it was this tall.
Right.
So the combination of understanding that manufacturers need to make metal inserts that are more robust in size and surface area for bonding is also critical because you can't have a tooth that this tall and a metal insert that's that short. It will break off. And so we just have to be cautious and understand. But monolithic materials, I think, are great. And when I spoke at the AO, I was a proponent of zirconia. And the whole concept of what's happening in vitro, that you could have the phase change and have dissolution of the zirconia, was really theory.
Mm-hmm.
But I think in practical applications, if you looked retrospectively at 10 million Glidewell Bruxer crowns, you know, they're working, or else you would have a huge number of remakes and a huge financial problem on your hands to redo those restorations.
And it's the biggest growing segment of our
Right. And it's a great service to patients. It really works very well. The only key element, if you are using a monolithic zirconia restoration, is that Hammerly in Switzerland and even Van Thompson looked at wear resistance. And I think that one of the key elements with zirconia is that it is very hard. The grain structure is very small, but it can be highly polished. And they showed that zirconia in regards to wear, monolithic zirconia in regards to wear, is not an issue. The key is that you have to be able to polish it and, of course, adjust it properly. You need to have the proper diamonds that if you are going to do a closal adjustment, you can't encourage, you know, stresses in the material that would then potentially cause failure later on. So, you know, like anything, you just have to understand how it's used. Right. And even on the lab side, when I worked with Michael Bergler, he even showed that because zirconia has the ability to be somewhat heat absorbing, the heating phase has to be longer and the cooling phase also has to be longer. And that was just part of the learning curve.
Exactly.
You know, I was sort of at the turn, you know, you and I being colleagues, is that we're probably around when they first made the first metal ceramic crowns. And they used nickel-chrome alloys, and the oxide layer was not self-limiting as you kept on firing the ceramics. So the veneer ceramics would delaminate and pop off. Does that mean that metal ceramics was bad? Well, the first generation metal ceramics were not so bad, but it required a learning curve. So it, like anything, it just takes time. The transition from, say, veneered gold, you know, gold acrylic veneered bridges to metal ceramic restorations to all ceramics. It's just a learning curve, but I think we've reached that point where we can have consistent outcomes.
Stephen, your research and your writing in recent years has been focused on anterior aesthetics, particularly in the implant field. Where are we now, and what are the trends, and what are you recommending for doctors now?
The key with implant therapy, there's still trends in regards to whether we do things delayed versus immediate. But there are many instances where we can do immediate therapy with the philosophy that you're replacing what you just took out. And we've done a lot of studies to look at outcomes in relation to aesthetic outcomes with the understanding that if you look at all the survival studies of immediate versus delayed, there really is no difference. It's about 96 to 97% survival rate for both issues. So if there's no real penalty in regards to survival, then why wouldn't you try to employ that technique of immediate therapy? So immediate implant therapy from an aesthetic standpoint has changed our profession, or at least our practice. We've adopted the techniques from Joe Kahn and Peter Worley. Peter Worley, 1998, a Californian, and Joe Kahn also at Loma Linda, 2003. And what was interesting, you know, really the first person to put an implant in on an upper bicuspid was Rich Lazara in 1989. And also Wagenberg and Frome, who were doing immediate implants in full mouths in 1988. It was pretty amazing, because Brandemark came out with his stuff in the early 80s.
Right.
And here are these guys putting into extraction sockets, which is amazing. But what's very interesting is that we have found that that technique, if understood, there's a protocol. It does require a certain skill set. But if you can learn that skill set, you're basically taking the same number of procedures, condensing them into fewer patient appointments. You're not shortcutting any procedures.
Right.
And that's about efficiency. Yeah.
But is there an opportunity to produce an even more aesthetic result?
We believe so. Yeah. In the data that we've looked at in regards to the last studies we did, we felt that there's certain key elements in regards to getting consistent aesthetic outcomes. One of the issues was really placing in a bone graft around the area and containing the graft with the provisional. What we originally did, Dennis and I, Dennis Tarner and I had wrote a paper about the dual zone concept, which I'm sure you've read about.
Sure.
And the concept was sort of by accident. And this, I want to give full credit to Dennis, because it's really Dennis's technique. I just wound up writing the paper with him. The bottom line is that we originally were placing in bone grafts around the implants where, you know, buckle to the implants. So in that gap, we would place a bone graft to try to, you know, preserve the shape of the ridge. And David Garber is really the one that I want to give credit in order to tell us that bone grafting is important for aesthetics. It might not be relevant for osseointegration, which Dennis and I showed that you don't need a bone graft for osseointegration. Position and position of the implant and smaller diameter implants, leaving the gap, allows the blood clot to fill in, and then you don't have to lose the buccal plate. But bone grafting supports and acts as a scaffold to maintain the shape of the ridge. But also, if you can bring the graft into the soft tissue, we also showed that the graft can get incorporated to the soft tissue and actually thicken it if you could protect and contain it with your provisional. And that's the marriage in the aesthetic outcomes of using provisionals, which I know Glidewell does a lot of provisionals. It's a very big business and it's successful. And the relevance of graft containment with a provisional restoration, which I think is extremely important. So from the standpoint of aesthetics, that combination seems to be a very good one. And the concept of intentionally bringing the graft material into the soft tissue is a strategy, maybe for restorative dentists, prosthodontists who don't do connective tissue grafting. Joe Kahn, though, showed that if you can do a connective tissue graft, not bringing the bone graft into the soft tissue area, or the tissue zone, as we call it, that you could basically get the same results. But a connective tissue graft is another procedure and requires a different skill set. So,
right.
But we can get great aesthetic outcomes. And the immediate therapy is really about preserving what's there. That is a very important concept. If it's there, Dennis always says, if it's there, leave it alone. and doing every strategy that we can do to maintain it. And so I think the game changer, at least in our practice, is immediate therapy. And those who have not adopted that will hopefully learn that, and that will change their practice. In fact, instead of taking 6 visits to do the same procedure, you can do it in 3 visits with better aesthetic outcomes if you do things right, with the same amount of risk if you let it the socket heal and go back and treat it as a delayed, because, you know, in all honesty, we have failures of implants in healed ridges, delayed sites,
sure.
No different than immediate sites.
Right.
The key with immediates is leaving the tooth out of occlusion. It's basically aesthetic healing abutment with the tooth form on top. But the bottom line really becomes that if you can understand that and you could get the same outcomes, if not better, in half the time, the reality from a cost-benefit standpoint to the dentist is that you can treat more patients. So instead of taking 6 visits, I can cut the procedures in half. That means I can treat more patients throughout the year. In the end, you're actually more productive. I haven't looked at my productivity numbers, but it has been increasing every year, and I think that immediate therapy has been responsible for some of that as well.
That's great. That's great information. Yeah. And I know you're very actively involved in research and development in this area, so we'll certainly be on the lookout for new developments coming.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Stephen, you lecture internationally, you teach, you have an active private practice, and I know you've got a wonderful young family. How do you balance all this?
Well, I think the reality is, the truth of the matter is that you learn through your mistakes. And, you know, I've been married twice, so it was a humbling learning process and a fortunate situation. But I learned that maybe it's better to have some balance in life. I think that You know, they always say, be careful what you wish for, because you may just get it. Mm-hmm. The problem is you don't know what it takes to get to that point and all the sacrifices that are required for that. So now that I have a young family, the mistakes that I learned early on, I'm trying not to make those same mistakes. So like tonight, I'm going to go home so I can be home with my kids on the weekends. Oh. And Dennis told me, you know, you got to do that. Keep that a priority, that, you know, business is business, but try to be home for your family, especially on weekends. And, you know, the 2 little boys, I've really enjoyed them so much. And now I have a balance between education about 40% of the time. So 2 days a week, I'm in education. And I practice 3 days a week. And that is a nice balance for me. And I think that some of these strategies, digital dentistry, being more efficient, immediate therapy, has allowed me to be very productive in 3 days, still do the education and research, which I enjoy, but still have time for my family. So I think keeping that in balance is sort of something important that I'm trying to focus on. My family is the most important thing to me right now. So I think if you keep that in mind, if you always keep the big picture in mind, you don't get wayward right. as much as we think. And I also try not to take myself too seriously. I appreciate the accolades in the beginning of the interview, but I don't try to take myself too seriously. I think that you always have to keep humble, because we're always learning. And anybody who thinks they know everything has stopped the learning process. And if you keep an open mind, I think it's important
to keep on going. Well, Stephen, I think your humility is part of what makes you such a great teacher and such an asset to our profession. And of course, I value all you've done for our profession, and I value your friendship. And I really appreciate you taking this time with us
today. It's my honor and pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Neil. Right. Appreciate it. Thank you.